morning, everybody. Just to say that in case you start getting restless before coffee time, we're deliberately overrunning by 10 minutes, but you will be compensated by big cups of coffee when it comes to it. Welcome to our first session of today. How can we improve access to finance for European companies in green sectors? It's lovely to see so many of you here, although the lights are so strong, I'm just getting a haze. I have four knowledgeable speakers with me, Christophe Kuhn, Jean-David Malot, Gerhard Humer, and Bernd Kopacek. And I will give them more of an explanation in a moment. I'm Renee Windham. I'm your session moderator for this morning. My background is as a TV reporter presenter for BBC and for ITV, now working as a moderator and media consultant. So by the way, I'm sure that you know already the exits are at the back, should you have to exit rapidly. Please switch off your mobile phones in case you haven't. And our interpreters, there are nine of them, by the way. The English is number one on your headphones, the French is number two, and the German is number three. We also have Neil and his team on social media. So, in the last few green weeks that we've had here in Brussels, we've discussed how to have a greener Europe, which you also heard in your introduction. And this is leading to more and more businesses deciding that they will go green and become part of a circular economy. But the problem is, of course, like all businesses, they need finance. So this is what we're discussing today. And just out of interest, as a show of hands, how many of you are actually a green business who is looking for finance? About three or four. And how many of you are financiers working in a financial section of some sort? And how many of you are business students? Not a lot. And general students? That's a nice, a fair smattering. Right, so we have quite an assortment, not that many financiers, so we're all going to learn quite a lot from our panel this morning. Right, the ethical question, of course, that some investors might be tempted to invest in green businesses out of an ethical feeling that maybe their profit will be slightly less, but they will have a better feeling and a better sustainable feeling about what they're doing to the planet. That's what we'll be discussing in this session. Banks and financiers who back a new business need some kind of certainty. You can't just throw money out and that's that. Really, you're thinking about profit and these innovative companies and businesses and how they're going to work. But of course, it's a vicious circle because in order to work, they need the financial backing. The EU has a number of grant schemes, including some that you may have heard of, Horizon 2020, which provides support for research, demonstration, and pre-commercial activities. There is also ESIF, which is the European Structural and Investment Fund. That's a regional fund. But if we want sustainable growth in the environmental business and for the circular economy, then private sector capital is vital beyond these grant schemes. There are other initiatives like InnovaFin and EFSI, the European Fund for Strategic Investment, and we'll be looking more closely at that today as well. These are debt and equity schemes to advisory services, and they can be the catalyst to bringing innovators and financial institutions together. Because at the moment, the greatest problem is the chasm between the innovative ideas and putting them into reality. I don't know if any of you in your countries have a program called Dragon's Den. In England on television, people come with their ideas and a panel look at them and see how suitable they might be for investment. And what is amazing is that only about one idea in 10 actually gets the investment. Well, I kind of think that this application for grants from the EU is a little bit like Dragon's Den. There are lots of good ideas, but by the time they find the funding, quite a few have to drop out. And this is really what we're tackling today, to make it easier and better for the good ideas to get the funding. We'll be hearing primarily from investors how they choose to invest in green SMEs and products, what role the various European Commission initiatives play, and also from Bernd himself, who runs a green company and knows about gaining investment. So now, without further ado, I'm going to introduce our first speaker. Our first speaker will be Christoph Kuhn, who is a business and finance graduate of Lyon and Cranfield Universities. He's director of the European Investment Bank's Mandate Management Department. By the way, all of you see that I'm speaking slowly. When you ask your questions, please speak slowly and clearly for our interpreters to interpret. Thank you. Mr. Kuhn oversees all mandate activities that support about a quarter of all the European Investment Bank's lending businesses. He's responsible for the mandate implementation of the so-called Juncker Plan, which you've heard about, the European Fund for Strategic Investment, as well as external lending outside the EU. He has a wide experience in corporate and investment banking across many countries of Europe. So now Mr. Kuhn will shed light on the European Fund for Strategic Investment and give examples of which green projects are being given investment support. Mr. Kuhn.
Thank you, René. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here. It is indeed exciting, and I think it is not only exciting, it is pressing, and the need to mobilize finance for climate action and for a better and green future in Europe is absolutely at the political edge at the moment. So I was asked to be very brief, so I'll be very brief. The European Fund for Strategic Investment is one part of the investment plan for Europe, which has three pillars. The first one is indeed access to finance, and this is what we are talking about here today. But we should also not forget the two other big pillars. The first one is the support to make actual investments happen on the ground through advisory activities, which is what we do as well. And it's also about the new investment platform that will be launched on the internet very soon by the Commission. Maybe Jean-David can shed light on it, but it's about to be published, which will bring together investors and promoters to make projects happen. And then the third pillar is really about creating a better investment-friendly environment due to structural reforms in Europe. These three go together. It's not only access to finance, it's the two others as well. Now, when we talk about access to finance, the European Commission and the EIB last year joined forces to set up this Juncker Plan, as they call it, as opposed to the name, which is called then as a pillar one, European Fund for Strategic Investment. It's actually not a fund. Many people think it's a fund. It's not a fund. It is a risk-sharing arrangement whereby the EIB and the Commission together pool money in order to cover risks from high-risk financings. And this will allow the EIB, together with partners in the market, these are banks, national promotional banks, equity funds, but also other IFIs like the EBRD, to do more and better when it comes to the support of investment. And when I say more, I mean that, for instance, for the EIB, it means we can do four times more risk finance than we were able to do before. And for other banks, it means that they can do even more because we provide them with value guarantees and with first loss credit protection. Very technical terms, you don't need to know that. But all I want to say is we want to do more and we want to do better. And better means that EFSI has to support projects that would otherwise not happen. It's very, very important. Let me come to the first results of EFSI before I finish my 5 to 10 minute introduction. EFSI was initially set up to trigger 315 billion euros of new investments. We have now 1 year of operation behind us. We can say today that based on the projects that we have already approved, and a large number of them already signed, we have triggered already 100 billion, so one-third of the targeted investments on the ground. When you look at sector distributions, you see that energy with 29% is the biggest share of the investments that we've triggered. And that share, around 50 to 60%, relates to climate action. So it is a very big, it's actually the focus at the moment of EFSI. So I think, you know, this discussion that we hopefully have today is really about the core of EFSI, and I'm very happy to shed more light later on if you have questions. But in the interest of time, I would leave the introduction like this and then come back later to questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kuhn. Our next speaker is Jean-David Malot. And Mr. Malot is in the Research and Innovative Directorate General of the European Commission. He spent a lot of time developing funding schemes, rules for participation, and so on. And he headed up the Regions of Knowledge and Research Potential programs for 5 years. Now he's working on innovative ideas for risk sharing and also coping with debt by making sure there are guarantees. So this time we go inside the European Commission to find out how funding for green projects works from the inside and how the guarantees for loans are covered. Mr. Jean-David Malot.
Thank you, René. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be among you this morning. I will try to be brief, quite a lot to say in 5 minutes, but like Christophe, I will summarize, and maybe we'll have the occasion to discuss the details later. Just a few remarks in introduction regarding the key issues that we would like to tackle this morning, which is the access to finance, in particular for green companies. Liquidity is certainly not the problem today. So this is not the problem. I mean, we have a lot of liquidity which are available on the market today. What are the problems today that have to be tackled could be summarized as the remaining risk averseness of investors, which has a number of reasons for this. Second, and one of these reasons is the information asymmetries that exist between the entrepreneurs and the investors. And very clearly, on the side of the investors, a clear lack of knowledge, and it's particularly true as far as circular economy is concerned, especially with new business models that have to be implemented. And in this context, I mean, we have also on the side of the Commission as one public funding source to review the way we are providing support. As far as existing instrument exists, Christophe already mentioned EFSI, which is indeed clearly providing support to this area, and in particular also to SMEs. Very likely today you will learn about the success of the SME part of EFSI, where also green SMEs can benefit from. But on top of this, you have other schemes that already exist, and one of our main challenges today is to ensure that they are complementary to each other. I just would like, in the context of Horizon 2020 that you cite in your introduction, René, to recall a few figures. Horizon 2020, which is a framework program for research and innovation, is for the first time a program which is putting a large focus not only on research, like it was the case in the past, but more on the innovation side. And it is illustrated by several things. First, for the first time, we have a target of providing at least 20% of the biggest part of our framework program, 20% of the budget of this biggest part of the framework program to SMEs, out of which at least 7%, which represents 3 billion euro, to support the growth of SMEs through a very particular instrument, which is the SME instrument, where we are supporting the growth of one SME. No obligation, like in the past, to have consortium, to work with big companies or research institution. You can submit a proposal alone. This could be complemented, in addition, by debt and equity products that we have developed together with the European Investment Bank and the European Investment Fund. Guarantees, and we have a product that is benefiting also from the FC support, which is providing all over Europe now access to loans for innovative SMEs, including green SMEs. And this product is more than a success because already now an amount of 9 billion euro of loans are available for the SMEs, and very likely we'll have the possibility in the next days, months, to announce that we will increase this support by at least 60-70%. The same apply for another area of finance, which is the equity finance, which is maybe even more important for the growth of SMEs, in particular also for the green SMEs. In Horizon 2020, but also in another program that is really dedicated to SME, which is COSME, we have decided together to have a facility which is providing equity financing in the early and in the growth stage. In the very next weeks, we will announce that we will scale up this scheme together with FC and with the EIB group, in the context of an investment platform for equity for SMEs. And in this context also, green SMEs could benefit. Having said that, and I'm trying to be as short as possible, it remains insufficient. And this is something that we have acted in the context of a conference that we have co-organized with the EIB in December, and which was devoted to the financing of circular economy. Those products are indeed providing general support to any kind of SMEs. But if you look at circular economy, or if you look at the particular area of energy efficiency or deployment of a new demonstration project, it does not make the trick. I mean, you remain with the difficulties that I evoke at the beginning of my speech. So, in this context, we have taken two decisions. First, together with the EIB, we are testing new pilots for projects that, as they are non-bankable, but could be bankable in the next 2 or 3 years following certain adjustments. And this is the idea of the Innofin Energy Demonstration Project, in a nutshell. But on top of this, we have decided also to explore the idea of an investment platform in the circular economy. And this is something that we are currently developing together with our EIB colleague in the context of something which is also key today and which was also mentioned by Christoph, which is the advisory schemes that exist at EU level. We developed one with the EIB in the context of innovation, which is called Innofin Advisory, but more than this, in fact, the Juncker Plan has launched this advisory hub, which is implemented by the EIB, and which is providing this kind of advice in order to build projects and to prepare them to be financially viable. A few words, and I will stop here, I promise. Christoph himself said in its introduction that in the Juncker Plan you have three strengths. I just evoked, in fact, two of them. The third one is certainly the most important one. This is the one which is dedicated to removing barriers, in a nutshell, for investments. In this context, we are, in the area of circular economy, trying to test some new ideas. Something that you will certainly hear about today is this idea of innovation deals. that we will try to initiate in order to help innovation ideas to fit with regulatory frameworks. And last but not least, and I will conclude on this one, we do think more and more that we have to ensure more cooperation, more combination, more blending between the existing instruments. And in this context, the initiative taken by Commissioner Moedas to launch a European Innovation Council in order to have something more fluid for the growth of innovative companies, including the one in the green area, has to be noted. And I would like in this at this moment to thank all of those that have contributed to the public consultation that closed that came to an end at the end of April. News on the European Innovation Council will certainly come by the summer on the basis also of this consultation. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Jean-David Malo. Thank you for being brief. And I'm sure there will be questions about your improvements for innovations and for scaling up the equity schemes and how that might work. But you, the audience, are the most important part of this, so please start honing your questions as we go to our third speaker, who is Gerhard Hümer. Mr. Hümer is almost the voice of SMEs in Europe. He's Director for Economic and Fiscal Policy at UEAPME, which is the European Association for Crafts and SMEs. He studied in Linz in Austria and started his career working in the Austria Chamber of Commerce, a very useful background for you. Mr. Hümer will talk about the differences between access to finance for green companies and those that aren't green, and also from a financing point of view, he'll look at what the regulatory challenges are, and also looking ahead to the next 10 or 20 years, which is useful for all of us and probably also a subject for discussion. So a very warm welcome to you, Mr. Gerhard Hümer.
Good morning, and thanks a lot for the possibility to speak and to discuss with you today. I am working for the interest of the 20 million SMEs at European level, and one of my main topics in economic policy is regulatory affairs and dealing with problems SME have to have access to finance. The two speakers before was explaining in a nutshell what Europe is doing with European taxpayers' money to help companies or projects to be financed, especially, of course, today in the green sectors. But we have to be very, very much aware that even this is very, very important, and I spent most of my time to deal with these people to improve these financial instruments. If we are not able to attract private finance, be it from private banks, be it from private investors, be it from other private or private institutions, to finance companies, to finance innovation, to finance investments, and to finance green projects, we will not be successful. And we have at the moment the two key challenges in Europe: that we have not enough appetite for private investors to finance investments in Europe. This may have to do that there are other places in the world where investing is more attractive from their point of view. And we have even more problems to finance from the private sector innovation, because it is related to a lot of risks, which is in the traditional European economic setup, especially on the continent, where we are mainly thinking about bank finance, bank loans, and similar things, not really matching together, because the risk of innovation cannot be borne by a traditional classical loan. Therefore, we have to think not only about public support instruments, not only, but also about how to make investments and innovation in Europe more attractive for private money. If we speak about the green sector specifically, then we have to ask the question in this discussion, is there really a difference in investing or financing projects in the green sector compared to investing or innovative projects in other areas? And I think this is the case. On the one side, there's a lot of political interest and willingness to do more in the direction of green sector. It is seen as a future economic area of activity, but also it's seen as an important area to change over to decarbonize the economy and so on and so on. And on the other side, we see that there is clearly a double challenge as regards the attractiveness for the private sector to finance this area. First thing is that very often greener projects may be more expensive compared to classical projects. And someone has to bear these costs if the customer is not willing to do it, or the consumer not willing to do it. The second thing is, and this is for me the most important point, what we see in Europe at the moment is, we have a much higher regulatory risk in the green sector than in other areas. If you don't know what will be your regulatory environment in 3, 5, or 7 years, you hesitate to put your private money in this area. And we see that the regulatory environment is very volatile in this sector. We don't know, look what the discussion in Germany about the Energiewende, the greening of the electricity sector. Look what happened in the car industry, etc. Yeah? If you change the games, the rules of the game too often, then you cannot expect that someone put money in a 7-year investment project or even in a longer in innovation project with a longer perspective. And therefore, I think next to public support for your sectors, it is even more important to convince regulators, politicians, regulators and politicians, that they set up rules which are coherent with need of private investors in the sense of that they are stable enough that you make risk, you can calculate the risk of these projects. And there are some ideas. We have, even so back to the car industry, yeah, in the Car 2020 project of the second class commission, where they said, let's, the regulators sit together with the stakeholders, from the environmentalists, the trade unions, the business associations, and discuss how far you can go with the regulatory challenges, how with the standards, that to motivate the companies to invest, to innovate, to help them to develop new markets, but not overdo it and kick companies out of Europe. And this is a very, very sensitive question. And it is a very controversial question, because of course environmentalists always want to have much more, and our people want to have much less. But you have to find here, and this is the challenge for policy, to find the right balance to make it. And then, of course, and this is my last point I want to make in the introduction, then you have this, the fact that green sectors or green economies have also an additional value for the society, which cannot be built up in the normal commercial process between investors, companies, and consumers. You have so-called positive economic effects on the environment, which are justified to be compensated by public money. Therefore, in the green sector, you have a justification to put more public money into guarantee schemes, into grants, etc., etc. This has to be designed. But also here, if you change the rules for giving grants too often, if you change the rule, the stated rules, for example, for compensating for investments in green power too often, then it increases the risk of this business and you will find less private investors. And this is the main message I would put forward today: is please give more attention to regulatory environment and be not too eruptive in this area, otherwise you will not reach out to private capital for green projects. Thank you.
Thank you for the passion, Gerhard, and it's interesting to, that you've highlighted the regulatory problem that acts as a bit of a barrier and the fact that it keeps changing as well, and also why there is less appetite perhaps for green investment. That was very useful and again, hopefully will spark off some discussion in a moment. So we now come to our final speaker, who's speaking from a different point of view from the three gentlemen in finance, because he has first-hand experience of looking for investment in green projects as a green businessman himself. Mr. Kopacek is from the Austrian Society for Systems Engineering and Automation. He has a doctorate from Vienna University in life cycle engineering, that was ahead of your time, I suspect, and a strong track record in green engineering. This includes scrap recycling and sustainable product development, reuse and engineering management. And he's at the sharp end of looking for investment in green products. So unlike our other three speakers, Mr. Kopacek will talk about looking for investment in green companies like himself and what sort of problems he's come and found. Bernd Kopacek, thank you.
Thanks for having me here. Obviously, I'm the only one looking using slides. That's not the reason because I want to do now a lecture, just the opposite. I want to give you a background where my statements come from. I just had a déjà vu, because when I first started to look for financing, I was in a similar room like here. I think it was not Green Week, but it was a similar thing. I was not sitting on the panel, I was sitting on your side, but I heard similar speeches from the European Commission that they do every effort to make it easy for us to get money from EIB or its predecessors, that it's so easy to get our money. And also from representatives of branch organizations, we will help you to get money and we pass you the way to make it easy for you. Okay, I felt it a little bit different. So let's walk through it. Short introduction. As already mentioned, I'm running a non-profit RTD organization, the Austrian Society for Systems Engineering and Automation, since nearly 20 years now. So that's the reason why my hairs are becoming more gray and gray. That's not the reason about green financing. And then, whenever we found or innovated something, we founded a company. So by accident, it was not my primary goal, therefore I studied engineering and not really business or economy. I became a serial entrepreneur or a green entrepreneur, how you would call me today. And at that time, circular economy was not a word or a headline, but you could summarize it like that. And since about 10 years, I also share my experience as a consultant mainly to IFC, the private sector arm of the World Bank Group, but also as a part-time lecturer to our students of the Vienna University of Technology. Because funny enough, they still produce graduates which have never heard about circular economy, about end-of-life management, about reuse, about recycling. So all new products which will be designed by them take the circular economy not into account. So first is a rather boring list of my companies. The first one, and it's still my so-called holding company, is ISL. What we do there is automation, reuse of mobile phones, and some consultancy. The next two, reuse and MTR, they were focusing on reuse. On the one hand side, reuse of components and IT products. On the other hand side, specialty on mobile phones. And later on, I also went into recycling. I had to found a new company because our main customers, the big producers like HP, like Dell, like IBM, they didn't like to mingle reuse activities and recycling activities, so I needed a new company called Ecotronics. Then when the V directive came into place, my idea was to look on a European-wide compliant solution and make it easy for the big companies. So I founded, together with other recyclers in Europe, Urn. And end of 2006, I sold these four companies, Reuse, MTR, Ecotronics, Urn. And I promised to myself I will not do that again, because I'm the person who is more interested in doing something new. So the main reason for selling this group, I have conquered 35% of the Austrian market, and I knew the next years I will not go up, because it's always easy to conquer a market, but it's much more difficult to defend that market share. So maintaining or losing market share is a little bit boring for me, and therefore I sold it before that. I kept my promise not very long, only 8 months, because then some Romanian, now friends, came to me and said, can't we do that in Romania? And I said, okay, Romania is a different country, but I know at least how to do it in Central Europe. Let's try it in Eastern Europe. So that's my, let's say, my main focus. I have also invested in other activities, property business, a little bit into green buildings, in business parks, mechanical engineering, machine building sector, some even internet provider to get the message across to a lot of people, and also renewable energy sector. Just to illustrate what we did, that's basically why we founded Reuse. We developed an automatic solution to take out components from printed circuit boards and reuse them to mainly to repair other components. So when we opened this plant, we invited several business partners. One of them was the largest repair facility or repair company for mobile phones. And they said, if you can do it for printed circuit boards, can't you do it for the complete mobile phone? We are repairing about, at that time, 14 million phones per year. 2 million of them are not repairable. It's called Beyond Economic Repair, BER models. Can't you take them apart? We take the components and repair other models with that. So we built a similar line only for mobile phones. The unlucky situation was, until our line was completed, this repair company went bankrupt. So then we had a nice technology, but no customer anymore. So we had to look for the customer, and we found at that time Nokia was the biggest, so we were very happy to find Nokia as a very reliable business partner, and this line gave us a lot of profit. So you see an image of this mobile phone dismantling line. This already I mentioned, so I not only invented or developed technologies, also let's say business approaches. In our Austrian Society for Systems Engineering and Automation, or short SAT, we are a non-profit membership organization. We have about 60 members. One third is always big enterprises like IBM, Philips, Siemens, Sony, Motorola, Nokia, Alcatel, and so on. So really the 20 of the 30 biggest brand names. One third are small and medium-sized enterprises. One third is other research institutes. When the V directive came into place, the big producers had the problem that the V directive on the one hand side is a European legislation, but the implementation, the transposition was on a national level. So it's V directive in Germany looks completely different than in Austria. In Spain, for example, it's a regional activity, so we have 15 different V directives in Spain alone. So they were facing 42 different implementations with 27 member states of the V directive. For every country, for example, HP would have to put half a person to follow it, to implement it thoroughly, and that was basically our business approach, to say, okay, you can remove all this obligation, just sign one contract with us for Europe, and we will do it instead of you, because this EARN, or this European V compliance solution, is based on recyclers, local recyclers, which anyway have to comply with the V directive, with the local implementation, so they know it by heart. Now, the last one, in order to also keep my 5 to 10 minutes, now we are in the activity to bring a special solution to extract critical metals, so rare earths and some other metals, from special electronics waste. What we see more and more is that the mechanical processing is optimized to a large extent, so now it comes more into chemistry to get even the smaller or more dispersed elements out. That's an image of our stationary plant. It's located in Italy. For example, it's a multi-purpose plant, so you can feed printed circuit boards, you can feed powders from CRTs, from lamps, from lithium-ion batteries, from PV modules, and so on, but always a powder, so on the right top, powder goes in, and out of a miracle, the separated metals are coming out. You see, I'm a mechanical engineer, that's chemistry, so for me it's really a miracle. Also, the next idea to always say, I'm always thinking both on technology solutions, but also on new business solutions. Our idea was, especially for SMEs, they will not be able to invest in such a big stationary plant. Investment cost is about $1.5 million. Why don't we make it mobile and go from small recycler to small recycler, like a milk run, and have it 1 month in Romania, 1 month in Austria, 2 months maybe in Spain, because it's much bigger. So that's an image of this plant. It's 2 containers, and we just started to operate or to run it 1 year ago, and it looks promising. Some more images. And my final statement to the déjà vu, I hope it's different, but at least for me, it was sometimes a challenge to get financing for all these activities. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Bernd Kopacek, and I'm sure we'll carry on finding out just how much of a challenge it is to get finance. Incidentally, thanks all 4 speakers for keeping it short so that the bulk of the session now is all of you. So do please come with loads of questions. Don't leave them till the end, because you find that people gingerly start and then at the end there are far too many. So be bold and a few hands up with a question. I'd be interested to hear, there were 2 or 3 people who put their hands up at the beginning who run green businesses. Could you put your hands up again, please? 1, 2, 3, 4. Lovely. Could you speak a bit from experience of trying to get finance yourself? And a question, maybe.
Hiya. My name is Marcin Kulik. I'm from a business called Smart Trace Software, the Internet of Waste. And we are a startup, so we're just starting the process of seeking for finance. What we developed is a platform that helps business to monitor all of their waste and help achieve better results in materials management. But on the bigger picture, what we're trying to create is the Internet of Waste, when we can provide data from regional national levels, presenting information on the problematic areas of the waste. So my question will be really how we can go about seeking finance. The advice will be to start from private sector, try to find finance there, or from, for example, question for Dr. Bernard, how did you go about it? Would you start doing research on the EU finance, or would you go for private sector first and try to raise capital there?
Thank you. Could you answer? Thank you.
Maybe first I share how I did it, and then maybe some advice later on. When I first founded these reuse MTR companies, I asked for a bank loan. At the very beginning, it was rather easy for me. I wrote to several banks, that's my idea. I even had from the Austrian Chamber of Commerce some coaching on how to write a nice business plan. And they were very excited. So at the very beginning, I had 5 offers from banks who wanted to give me 1.3 million euros. This is basically what I asked for, which is nice because I had no track record, I had no equity or something like that. So I chose one. And of course, after the first years, not all figures in our financial statement were like in our business plan. So what was happening? The risk manager of the bank became very nervous. Or it was not even the risk manager, it's now a software. So the software raised a flag and said, Mr. Kopacek is a danger to kill the whole bank. I'm not sure with 1.3 million, because at that time I spent only one. So the first thing what they did was to freeze my loan limit at 1 million instead of the 1.3 where I paid all the banking fees for, all the taxes for, and so on. Then the risk manager invited me and also, of course, the regional director, who was my counterpart when I signed this loan. And as it was a bank where my father was working as a professor at the university, so he had some money, he came with me. What was later on a very good situation, because I think if I would have come alone as a that time 29-year-old person, I'm not sure if I would be able to present such a track record. I think they would have sent me to bankruptcy rather soon. But in front of my father, who had more than this 1 million lying on their bank, they didn't dare. So what they did is they strongly advised us to start discussion with public and private startup funds, with business angels, with venture capitals, so both public as well as private equity. What followed next? We discussed more than a year with all of them. And all of them told me, very interesting idea, and I think that's the future, but please earn your first 1 million or 2 million, and then we will invest. So nice. And then I had several sleepless nights until now, but that was one of them. After about 1 year, and they saw that nobody wants to invest, even with my father in the background, the bank still said, we give you 3 more months, and if you don't succeed to be profitable, at least on a monthly basis, sorry, but we have to send you to bankruptcy. Of course, that was not a nice night after that after this discussion. But what happened next? We signed this contract with Nokia, so we changed from a monthly minus of 30,000 euros to a monthly plus of 100,000 euros. So the next quarter results, which we sent to our bank and also to this public and private equity and startup funds, what a surprise, when we earned more than 100,000 euros per month ourselves, all of them were out of a sudden willing to invest. But then we didn't need them anymore, because the 1 million we paid back within 10 months, and that's how we started our business. So we were rather close to becoming bankrupt, but luck was with us that we didn't do that.
But you didn't have any EU funding at all?
At that time, we had some grants for not EU funding. We had some national grants to develop our first 2 lines, but not really on the operational side, just to develop that, and it was about 25% cash and 25% credit or loan. So now my advice, what I experienced at that time, it always makes sense if you take somebody more experienced with you to such bank. So I would not say it's a either or situation. I would go in both directions. But for me, I said later on, maybe I can give some advice what I would change. What I think would have helped me a lot would be something like a mentoring program, where somebody experienced goes with me and says, of course, I also knew that my business plan will never happen like I write it. Also to a 27-year-old person, that's logic. Because how can you predict the future? Then I would not have to work. Then I go to stock exchange and become rich only because I can predict what the next developments will be. So I would try to combine that. What for me was also very important to find a good tax consultant and a good lawyer. Because with a good lawyer, you normally don't need him really, but it's always good to have. And a tax consultant is really important, at least in Austria, because all the taxes you can save, you don't have to finance. So this will be also one of my ideas on how to trigger green financing would be to look on the tax situation. For me, it's rather strange that we, as a message or as a question, we as green startups, we pay the normal taxes. These taxes are then reduced by the costs of bureaucracy to collect the taxes, tax authorities and all this stuff. Then a part of that is sent to national funds, European funds, whatever. Also there it's reduced by operating costs, by overhead. And then we get part of this money, but much less, of course, back. Wouldn't it be much more interesting to have a tax exemption or tax reduction for green startups or green investments?
You've made two very useful suggestions there, Bernd. One is the mentoring, which I will ask our financiers about, because I don't know if we have such a thing. And the other is the tax reduction idea, which is also very practical. Gerhard Hümer, you were going to
maybe give... Maybe a third one to round it up, because for me, I think, as it was also mentioned already here and already written in the program, the most important would be to train the risk managers or change the software in the bank.
As you say, you dialogue more with software than with human beings, yes. Gerhard.
Starting with this last point, I'm afraid you will never find in these times a bank who will give you for such a project 1.5 million euro. This time was in the 90s, maybe a little bit better still, but now, especially after the financial crisis, you will not find banks which also have their responsibility towards their deposit money, et cetera, et cetera. Also, we don't really like that banks take these risks. The big question is, who else takes the risk? We have in Europe, especially in continental Europe, it's a few exemptions, a very, very underdeveloped equity markets. Especially in your country, in Austria, also in Germany, the tax regimes for private investors are not incentives, but really disincentives to invest in private activities. If we accept for a moment the fact that banks will not be the risk taker for such projects, then at the moment the politicians' answer is, and also our answer very often, taxpayers has to do it, via regional programs, via national programs, via European programs. But is it really our vision for the next 5-10 years that the risk-taking in the economy is done by taxpayers alone? So what our challenge is to develop
new capital equity risk-taking instruments where private investors, which may look for more profitable investments, which may look for higher rendites, can be taken in. But therefore, we need an equity market and a risk capital market, which at the moment doesn't exist. The Capital Market Union tries a little bit to go in this direction. The Commission, is this project? But if we are not changing our tax systems, if we are not changing our accounting systems, if we are not changing our insolvency regimes, we will not be able to build up a European capital market. And therefore, we have to look for new solutions. And what we recommend at the moment, and then I stop, is better than giving a grant to such projects, try to create as much leverage as possible and try to get with a little bit of taxpayers' money to mobilize as much as possible private money. This is the direction of the Juncker plan. This is the direction, the concept of financial instruments like guarantee schemes, like what Jean David is doing with his Innofin projects, etc., etc. But we have to focus on mobilizing private money with the taxpayers' money and not only give taxpayers' money and say, we take the risk.
A bit like PPI in England, private and public partnership. It's very sort of contradictory that at the same time as we want the green economy to flourish and the circular economy to build up, we are also in a moment of austerity and crisis in Europe. It's sort of contradictory, and they're fighting each other. And as you say, you need a new current that says we will invest and this is how. Maybe there'll be a tipping point in that. From the financier's point of view, I'd like to hear more about mentoring and also more development on what Gerhard was saying, Mr. Christoph, perhaps.
Thank you. Maybe I would like to also give you a little bit of my view on what to do as a startup with ideas, with a business plan, seeking for finance. I think there are a number of rules these days that have to be respected. The first one is find someone who understands your business and understands your idea. That's the most important one. Find partners, be it on the mentoring side or on the finance side, that actually understand. It's not easy, I know. And especially in a world where venture capital is not really enough available in Europe, where funds are not, all of them are specialized, so it is difficult. But you need to find partners that understand it, because otherwise it happens exactly what you experienced, which is that you face yourself in a situation where you are in a catch-22, where your partner doesn't really understand what you're doing, and uses standardized models to kind of, you know, use it for natural reflexes as a bank, which is either send you in bankruptcy or maybe give you a little bit more money, but not much, and give you a lot of tight deadlines. So understanding the business is key. Secondly, mentoring, advising is key. That's why we, on the European side, and of course it's never enough what we do, but at least the direction is right, to invest in advisory schemes and make people, support people to the extent it's possible, and work with partners on the ground that can bring knowledge into teams, into startup teams. And the third one, which is absolutely crucial, we have to bring in private investors. If someone believes that we can make a big difference with the scarce taxpayers' money that we have in Europe, it will never work. We need much more. And in order to do that, we need to find smart ways to bring in the private sector. There, as Jean-David said in the beginning, is not a matter of liquidity in the market. The market is full of money. It is about bringing the right people together, make them understand about the opportunities, and provide platforms where they can invest with a reasonable return expectation. That's all about it is.
What about a competitive edge? I was quite surprised when I looked at the topic that none of the green industries either have to tender in a competitive way, nor is there any kind of time limit for them to submit the idea to see whether the finance will come. Perhaps if you had the competition and the limit, it might focus minds a bit more.
Well, of course, and some people do not believe us and so on. It's not very formalistic to ask finance from us. At the same time, it's not easy too, because first of all, SMEs cannot come to us directly. They come to intermediaries, which we back, which we support with either guarantees, with equity, etc. So still you have to convince them of your business case. Having said this, there is no form that you fill in to EIB if you are an SME and you want to seek finance. This doesn't exist. We work with emails, we work with telephones, people call us, say, can you help us? And we refer them to a fund, we refer them to an advisor, and we try to bring people together. Of course, for large projects, I'm not sure if there's someone in the room who's promoting a large project, we also act directly. But for SMEs with good ideas, which, by the way, is half of the Juncker Plan is SME financing. So clearly, the focus is SMEs. 50 billion out of the 100, 50 billion out of the 100 that we have achieved today goes to SMEs. So it is indeed, at the moment, we are talking about half the results achieved go to SMEs. Therefore, I can only encourage you, talk to us, talk to investors, talk to associations, and bring the right people together. That's the key.
I'm only using the model from television because when people used to have program ideas vaguely and said, I need money, they got a few ideas. When they said, right, you're going to competitively tender for a slot at a given time by a given date, they got far more innovative ideas because there was that edge to it. That, so maybe it would work in your department as well. Jean-Marie, with please.
Yes, a few reactions on what was said. I fully shared what was said by the three others speakers. My first advice is indeed, as Christoph said, be or prepare yourself to be investment ready. Because the key problem today that we faced in a number of cases is that you may have the most wonderful idea possible, but you are not able to share it in an exciting way towards investors. So if you are not able to speak the same language, if you have not the right people with you, I mean, you will have a lot of difficulty to sell it. Second, and indeed, as Christoph said, I mean, you need a team, in fact. I mean, it's impossible that you alone, you are able to cover all the needs, be it intellectual property rights, be it knowledge of the market in which you will work. So you need to develop this team. In this context, it's not to make marketing for our own product, but we have, because this is a real issue, we have developed program in order to support entrepreneurs like you in this context. It could be in accompanying measures in Horizon 2020 or in COSME, or it could be also in the context of the SM instrument, because this is eligible to support this kind of activity, in particular in order to make you ready for the third part of the SM instrument, which is the one where we would like to see investors coming in order to support your growth. I would like to come on what was said regarding the behavior of banks. I mean, it's fully right what Gerard said. I mean, the situation of the 90s cannot be compared to today. I mean, what has been decided in the context of Basel III or Solvency II explain also the reason why today, despite the fact you had a lot of liquidity, the banks need to be reassured when they want to invest in a project. In this context, it's more than ever important to see how you can mix source of financing. I mean, lending is one possibility, equity is another one, be it in early or in later stage, be it via BA or family business or venture capitalists, but also grants. And we are suffering by not enough capacity of blending money today. I mean, we should create schemes in order to tackle the kind of situation that you had, because it may be perfectly understood that a bank does not agree to continue with the lending at a certain moment, which could be a difficult moment in your development, but this could be for a temporary time covered by a grant or a gap grant or something of this kind that could help for the future. The problem is that we are not necessarily able today to ensure that all the relevant actors are sitting around the same table at the right moment. The idea of investment platforms, the idea of blending instruments that you can find in the Juncker Plan, as you said rightly, I mean, Christoph and Gerhard, is in this spirit. And this is something that we would like to develop more. Allow me a last remark on two points. Maybe a first one which is not politically correct, but I mean, this is also the purpose of this kind of exchange. Indeed, we absolutely need private investments, no doubt about this, and in particular in the equity area. Sometimes all of us, we hear that look at what is happening in the United States. More or less, you have no more investments coming from the public sector in the early stage or in the growth stage of equity. It's true, but it's true today. Look at what was the situation in the 80s or in the 90s in the US. Look how much public money was invested, especially at federal or at national or at state level, to support the asset class at a certain moment. So you need the combination of support from public and private money at a certain moment. If we create an appetite for the private investors to come in this asset class, which is not very attractive today, let's be clear, because you have not the return that you can expect on short term. If we create the condition to a better knowledge, to a better understanding of the market, because you have a security or a part of the security which is taken in the form of a risk-taking by public authorities for a certain period, maybe we could attract more and more private investors. And at a certain extent, this is also what is behind the idea of the Juncker Plan. The reason why the EU is providing a guarantee to the EIB, it's also to provide a kind of security for private investors to come in addition to what will be provided by the EIB group. Last remark, and I stop, on something that you said that was very, very important, Mr. Kopacek. We are suffering in Europe of another thing, the difference of the national legislations. It's a huge problem for a company which has a European market. It's a big problem for any kind of investments. I was discussing with the promoter of the tunnel between Austria and Italy, which is built today, a pure nightmare. For the same kind of norms, the procedures in national level are not the same, not the same timing, a pure nightmare. So we have to think on how we should improve this part. One way to do it in certain area would be to think about not necessarily to harmonize national legislation, because it's a huge work, but to create common legislation in certain area via the idea of the 29th state. The state which does not exist, but which normally exists, which is the European Union. And where, when we have EU added value scheme, we should agree among states, with the support, of course, of the European Union as such, of common rules in order to ease the economic development. So,
thank you very much. Thank you for your excellent question. Because we overran at the beginning, I said we were overrunning probably by 10 minutes if we can. If there are any burning questions, then we will add another few minutes. So any more questions, please? Because that was the other person, there were two more industries there. One of you had an SME? Ah, there's a question over there, please. Yes.
Thank you. My name is Filip Jakopovic. I'm from the Council of the European Union. I have a question for Mr. Mal and Mr. Kuhn, And that is in the context of speaking about taxpayers' money and competition, there is also a segment of fossil fuel subsidies. European countries are investing money into gas and oil, are offering tax breaks. So is there a possibility of unlocking that money and redirecting it to a greener future? That was also one of the topics of the recent G7 meeting.
Thank you very much indeed. That is also a topic of the leave it in the ground people, and also fracking comes into that as well, actually. So this is about, would you like to answer first, either of you, about the investment in, it's about investing in green energy as opposed to money that's being subsidizing the gas and coal industries in Europe still.
I mean, indeed. It's one of our main challenges, especially following the agreement in Paris after the COP21. You certainly heard about the energy union objective in the priorities of President Juncker. And very likely by the end of this year, a number of actions will be announced in the context of the energy union. Including as far as the research and innovation dimension is concerned. Yeah, I will be brief. And in this context, one of our main objectives would be to limit as far as possible subsidy to fossil fuels. It's something, when you are touching the tax area, which remains in the end of member states. It's not something which is in the end of the union. So our political message will be there, and we count on member states to do their best.
Thank you. Have you got something to add to that?
No, not really. Is it working? Yeah, not really. We in the EIB, we are not so much engaging in grant or taxpayer money allocation. We, of course, take our view when it comes to capital markets and lending instruments, and we, of course, think there's interesting ways of deploying that money with an investment multiplier effect that we can generate with financial instruments, but we are not engaging into a discussion.
Who is responsible in that case?
It's the policymakers. It's not the EIB. It's the European Commission.
Fair enough. So the gentleman should actually directly try and... How can you influence the Commission in any way?
Of course not. No. No. It's not our role. This is not what we are here for. We are here to help people in the market.
Yeah.
And the European Commission is the policymaker.
If I may, René, on this, again, and in this context, I just would like to recall something that sometimes is forgotten. It's not the Commission who is deciding. The Commission, due to the treaty, is only proposing things. At the end, it's Member States, Council, and the Parliament who are the power of this, who have the power of decision. We are just then implement. So we can propose, and this is the purpose of a number of communications that we are doing in order to initiate the debate. And we will do so in the context of what was discussed a few seconds ago. But at the end, we have not the power to decide. The only area where we have full delegation of power from the member states is on competitiveness. On competition. This is the only way. This is the only area. For the rest, we are just proposing. So count on us to put on the table this kind of improvement. But please be also on your side, advocate for this towards your member states.
Well, that's been the start of a very lively discussion. We almost need another hour to go around. Bernd, you have a very quick remark to the end.
I have questions, because I'm becoming part of the auditorium. I was listening to your things, and for me struck two or three things. One thing was It's clear that bank cannot finance because of Basel III of Solvency II. Why don't we change that? Why don't we change the Basel rules for green startups and investments? Somebody must have written them. I'm rather sure that the European Commission was somehow involved, or EIB has a stake there. Why don't we change them? Tax incentives. You say we have to mobilize private equity. Why do Austria, for example, punish private equity? How can I ask my finance minister? For me, it's easier to go to European Commission officials to discuss with them. No, not hit them, but give them nice inputs, or nice ideas to think about, than to go out to our national politicians. They are more God than here in Brussels. Why can't we create tax incentives for business angels, venture capitalists like that? And funding system? I'm still trying to limit the bureaucracy for the SMEs to get this money. Why can't we establish also a co-investment scheme? Like I said, if you have found a venture capitalist, a private equity investor, a business angel, public funds is just doubling it or giving 50% of it or whatever. It would be a rather easy decision, I think, for public investment to say if somebody knowledgeable from the private sector believes in this idea, why shouldn't I give also money to it?
And yes, very last word.
The European Commission has very limited resources to support directly via European instruments SMEs. It's about, let's say, 5 billion euro for 7 years for 20 million companies. There's much more money available at national level and even much more money available at the structural funds spent at national and regional level. What we have done the last 10 years is to make it possible to use this money also for financial instruments, for business angels, for mezzanine finance, for loan guarantees, etc., etc. What we see is that member states and regions are still very much hesitating to use these possibilities. They are still giving grants to their old friends instead of using this money for innovative projects, etc., etc. So I think a message, not to you here, but to the auditorium, to the politicians, we have to bring the innovation in financing, which was developed at the European level during the last 10 years, now also to the national, to the regional levels, because for the majority of smaller projects, we will not be able to do it at European level. We need the regions, we need the national levels, and to create there the right instruments and the right regulatory environment.
Excellent. I wish we'd almost started on all these points because we can take them on, but hopefully they will come up in some of your future discussions. And obviously there is a chasm between those looking for investment, who've stated out their case very clearly, and the ones who are giving the investment. And the appearance, which was very valuable to know, that private finance can be mixed in with public finance and taxpayers' money to produce probably, hopefully, even more money. And the importance of mentoring for those of you in green industries who want to know how to start to be sure to get the money and how the investors can be sure that they will get a return and that they will choose a green business rather than an ordinary business. So thank you for so many ideas in such a short time. I appreciate that you all kept it brief and very much to the point. And thank you, the audience, for being tremendously attentive and for your good questions. So thanks to Bernd Kopacek, Jean-David Malou, Christophe Kuhn and Gerhard Humer. I'd also like to thank our excellent session organizers. Congratulations, because you were very good. Monica Sonia, Maria Luisa Tambora, Roel Marsman, all very good communicators with me and with the team. Danai Vuvuzzi, Sara Florido Villa, who were very supportive to our speakers. And the unseen people up there, which is Neil and his social media team, who are busy putting it all on the web and communicating it. Olivier and the technicians, a vast array of them with the lights and the sound and everything else. They're There are 9 interpreters. William Long is the head of the 9 interpreters. Normally I name them, but 9 is a bit much. But thank you all for your interpreting. So on behalf of the Directorate General for the Environment of the European Commission, do enjoy the rest of your day here. Enjoy all the other topics and communications. And it's been very nice to see you all. Thank you all. Strong. It's easier said than done. Face up, you're gone.